As you're turning to Acts chapter 15, verse 23, let's pray. So, Father, we thank you for this time that you've given us to praise your name, to honor you with praise, to be in fellowship together, and now to walk through the teaching of your word. Father, we ask that you would open our eyes and our ears and our hearts and let them be soft and sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit, that we would hear what it is that you have to say to us. And Father, I pray and ask that you would shut down distractions that would try to stop your word from accomplishing its purpose in our hearts and our minds. Lead us, Lord, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Acts chapter 15. So I'm going to read from verse 23 all the way through the rest of the chapter if you want to follow along with me. We'll start at the letter that was written to the Gentile church. Verse 23 of Acts 15. And they sent this letter by them, the apostles and the brethren who are elders, to the brethren in Antioch and Syria and Cilicia who are from the Gentiles, greetings. Since we have heard that some of our number, to whom we gave no instruction, have disturbed you with their words, unsettling your souls. It seemed good to us, having become of one mind, to select men to send to you with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, men who have risked their lives for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, we have sent Judas and Silas, who themselves will also report the same things by word of mouth. For it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay no greater burden than these essentials, that you abstain from things sacrificed to idols and from blood and from things strangled and from fornication. If you will keep yourselves free from such things, you will do well. Farewell. So when they had sent away, they went down to Antioch, and having gathered the congregation together, they delivered the letter. And when they had read it, they rejoiced because of its encouragement. Judas and Silas, also being prophets themselves, encouraged and strengthened the brethren with lengthy message. After they had spent some time there, they were sent away from the brethren in peace to those who had sent them out. But it seemed good to Silas to remain there. But Paul and Barnabas stayed in Antioch, teaching and preaching with many others also the word of the Lord. Verse 36. After some days, Paul said to Barnabas, "Let us return and visit the brethren in every city in which we proclaim the word of the Lord and see how they are." Barnabas wanted to take John, called Mark, along with them also. But Paul kept insisting that they should not take him along, who had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not gone with them to the work. And there occurred such a sharp disagreement that they separated from one another, and Barnabas took Mark with him and sailed to Cyprus, but Paul chose Silas and left, being committed by the brethren to the grace of the Lord, and he was traveling through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. So what we have here is, we've already gone through this part of the chapter. We walked through it last week. We had a good picture of what was painted for us. But what I want to back up and look, because within this part of Scripture, a lot of times I'm asked, as a pastor, people ask me, what's God's will for my life? How do I know where God is directing me? How do I know what God wants me to do? Or how is he going to lead me? And I think in this part of the chapter, we're going to see really clearly how God leads his church. Because I think it's shown to us, if we look a little deeper in the chapter, I think within this chapter, we're going to see some ways that you will know the will of God for your life. And as we walk through the end of chapter 15, we're going to see how God led his people at that time, and he still leads them the same way today. So it's an amazing picture, I think, painted for us in Scripture. But we're going to look deep at it. Let's look at verse 23 through 25 in this letter. It says, "And they sent this letter by them, the apostles and the brethren who are elders, to the brethren in Antioch and Syria and Cilicia, who are from the Gentiles, greetings." So they have this letter. They send it out to the Gentile churches in this whole area. And it says, verse 24, since we have heard that some of our number, to whom we gave no instruction, have disturbed you with their words, unsettling your souls. Verse 25, it seemed good to us, having become of one mind. One of the first pictures that we're going to see here is how God leads His church. God leads His church through the church agreeing together on His word. We have a picture painted for us. The letter that was written to the church in Antioch states right here that the believers in Jerusalem were in one accord. They were united together with what they believed the Lord was showing them in His Word. And one of the first and most important pictures of how God leads His people is that the church itself agrees together on His Word. And because of that, what went forth, so very important, direction given to the church. God leads His church, we know, by the Holy Spirit, but how does He work? How is it that one person says, well, I believe God's leading me in this direction. Another person says, well, I believe God's leading me in this direction. Another one says, well, God's leading me over here in this direction. Like, wait a minute, which direction is God going here? Well, as a corporate church, He leads His church. And by His church agreeing together first on His word. What is the standard of our life supposed to be? The word of God. And so basic, God's not going to lead me to go rob a bank. I believe God told me to go rob a bank. The church needs money for the new building project. So does anybody agree with me in that? No, doesn't go according to His word. So the church agreeing together on His word. And it's important because in my own life, in your own life, when you're weighed down with the issues of life, and in today's day and age, lifestyle, or you're pressed down with the issues of doctrine, you need to sit down and find out what the leaders of the church and the church itself say about it. You can go back in history. You can read 200 years ago. We have writings from 1,500 years ago. We have church writings. Go back and read Spurgeon. Go back and read Polycarp and the things he wrote from the disciple John. Go back and read Augustine. Go back and read the church history that's there, and you'll see just what the stance of the church and its leaders stood upon what maybe you're struggling with something. You know, today's day and age, we get alternate lifestyle. People struggle. Where does that stand in the church? Well, hold on. Go back and look at what the church agreed on according to the Word of God. And look at what it's agreed on for the last 2,000 years. Never to judge the sinner, but always to condemn the sin. Always to see someone through exposing sin for what it is and then showing them the cross so salvation can forgive that, can give that life a brand new start. It's never often where it is today. So one of the ways God leads His church, and we see it really clear, is through the church agreeing together on His word. In fact, Proverbs 22:28 says, "Remove not the ancient landmark which thy fathers have set." So here, it's through the wisdom of the church agreeing together on the word of God, presently and historically, that God led His people significantly. That's the first thing that we see in there. Verse 25 again, it says, to take select men to send to you with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, men who have risked their lives for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore we have sent Judas and Silas, who themselves will also report the same things by word of mouth. The second thing we see of how God led His church right here. He leads His church through gifted men and women in the body. That's how he's always done that. There are men and women that God will raise up for a certain purpose, whether it's in the teaching of His word, the directing of a ministry, but they're gifted of the Holy Spirit to give you, the church, what it needs to give direction. You think of this, you know, here I stand, I'm teaching the Bible. So that's a gift from God. It is not a knowledgeable thing of myself. You know, my parents are here. Even my Aunt Mel's here. They can all tell you what I was like as a little kid. There is no way I should be teaching the Bible. And yet God has given the gift of the exposition of His Word for the purpose of building the body of Christ. So God has always led His church through gifted men and women in the body. In fact, Ephesians 4, verse 11 through 13 says this, "And He gave some as apostles and some as prophets and some as evangelists and some as pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ." We look into this word. How can you know God's will for your life? Well, you can know His will for your life through the church agreeing together on His word. You can know His will for your life by the wise and mature men and women that God has gifted in the exposition of His word. So it would be you and I would say, you're a wise man, you're a wise woman when you approach every Bible study or every time of fellowship expecting the Lord to speak to you through those who are called to exposit His Word. You should never come here to hear what I have to say. That's the truth. Never come to this fellowship to hear what I have to say. You come to hear what God has to say through the exposition of His Word. You come to hear what God has to say as the church begins to agree together as where do we stand on this subject in our day and age today? Where did they stand on it 200 years ago? Where did they stand on it 1,500 years ago? Where did they stand on it when it was proclaimed by God in that stance? And we're always step in that direction. So there's a leading of the Holy Spirit in that way. Look at verse 28. "For it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these essentials, that you abstain from things sacrificed to idols and from blood and from things strangled and from fornication. If you keep yourselves free from such things, you will do well." And we broke that down last week and looked at it in detail. But one of the things that I see here in verse 28 and 29 is another way God leads His church. And He leads His church through the gifts of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives gifts to the body. And the gifts have a purpose and a reason. Earlier in this chapter, and we read it last week, there's all kinds of debate and discussion. Are we saved by the law? Are we saved by grace? And everybody's kind of debating this whole thing. And what happens is James kind of stands up in the room and speaks out boldly. And he says an unbelievable thing. And something really interesting happens when he says it. He stands up and admits, let's say we're all debating and discussing what direction the church needs to take in this stand. And out of the clear blue, James stands up and he proclaims what the Word of God already proclaimed so many years before, that grace would be given over to the Gentiles. Nowhere in the Old Testament did God say the law would be given over to govern the Gentiles. He never said that. Straight through the whole Old Testament, He says the grace of God is given over to the Gentiles. For a time, for a season, for a purpose. So he stands up and he says, you know, what are we doing? No, God's grace is given over to them. And he makes the proclamation in God's word. What he does is he gives a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge. That's a gift of the Holy Spirit. And a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge. It's a gift given by the Holy Spirit to give clear direction to the decision the church was about to make. And you know what it did? Everybody that was arguing and debating, what'd they do? Everybody hushed. All of a sudden he stands up, he speaks this word, and everybody just stops. And everybody's still. It calmed everybody's heart. It calmed everybody's mind. It calmed everybody's spirit. Because that's what a word of knowledge from the Holy Spirit does. It puts order into disorder so that the church is calm. So that there's not confusion racing all over the place. And it's pretty awesome because everybody not only calmed down, but everybody united together. And what'd they do? They wrote the letter we're reading now. And they sent it out agreeing together Because that's what this does. And I think it's the same is true for us as the church today. There's times when during what it seems like nothing but endless dialogue or discussion, and somebody suddenly stands up and speaks, and all of a sudden out of the clear blue, it settles your mind and it puts you at peace, the peace of God deep down inside your heart, your mind, you know it. All of a sudden you're like, wow, this is the Lord that just spoke a word of wisdom or a word of knowledge. That's the gifts of the Spirit have just been administered. And that's how it works. You ever be in a conversation and it's going nowhere? And you're wondering, where are we going? And somebody just speaks into it, somebody from the body of Christ, and they speak this word of knowledge, not that they thought it up themselves. It was from the Lord. And it puts a peace deep in the heart. It calms the mind. And there's a settling. Wow, thank you, Lord. I needed to hear that. I can't tell you how many times that we're in the midst of conversation and somebody just pops up. We're at the men's study and we're walking through the Word and somebody just comes out with something and everybody goes, wow, yeah, thank you, wow, that was the Lord. Needed to hear that. And that person's like, I don't even know what came out of my mouth. It just happened that way. That's a word of wisdom. It's a word of knowledge. The gifts of the Spirit being administered. I think when you're struggling to find God's will for your life according to His Word, put yourself in the place where you're among God's people and words of wisdom and words of knowledge are being exercised, and listen for Him. Because if you do that, you will hear Him clearly. Remember we looked at signs and wonders in the last couple weeks? That God gives a sign, God gives a wonder, and we see Him all the time. All the time. Do you ever get to that place in your life where you're like, you just can't make this up. How did this happen? Well, God did it. God was leading. God was directing in it. The Holy Spirit was governing this whole thing, and you thought that it would never work out, and all of a sudden God takes it, and you go, wow, Lord, you did what man could not do. You did what I couldn't do. And that's a word of knowledge or a gift. One of the gifts of the Holy Spirit being administered, all for the direction of the church, all for the church to receive direction. Remember that we've looked at this before, but Christianity is not where we're going. Every other religion on earth is trying to end up somewhere. In Christ, what He did on the cross, in dying on the cross and rising again to life, what was offered to us was eternal salvation and forgiveness of sins. Now I can, by faith in Christ, I can be assured that I'm going to heaven for eternity. So my destination as a Christian is secure. That should never be a question in my life again. So my Christianity from this day forward is about the journey. It's about my pilgrimage on this earth. Will I lean upon my old nature? Will I lean upon my new nature? How do I deal with this issue? How do I deal with this issue that's in front of me or this circumstance? How do I handle this? And learning to lean upon the Lord wholly for it. And as He sees you through, you realize, Lord, Your hand is upon my life. You're leading me down this road. 10 years ago, you would have never found me in a place with a bunch of people praising Your name. And yet all these things, tragedy happens in my life and circumstance and turmoil, and all of a sudden, years later, boom, here I am with joy in my heart, wanting to be amongst God's people. That's a wonder. That's a sign. That's the working of the Holy Spirit and God moving someone along that pilgrimage that we're walking. But for you and I that are in Christ, our destination is secure. Never let that stumble you again. Our security is that my faith in Him is settled where I'm going to be for all of eternity. This walk now is about the journey along the way. So we see that God leads His church through the gifts of the Spirit. Look at verse 30. It says, so when they sent away, they went down to Antioch. Having gathered the congregation together, they delivered the letter. And when they had read it, they rejoiced because of its encouragement. Judas and Silas, also being prophets themselves, encouraged and strengthened the brethren with lengthy messages. We looked at that in detail last week, too. Got to talk long. Back, 200 years ago, when they used to preach. They preach from 7 a.m. till 3 p.m. And at 3 p.m. they stop to eat. Then they would come back and they finish preaching till 6 or 7 p.m. I don't know. We might want to try that sometime and see how it works out. In fact, if you look back in history, you know how they had the pastors had the robes on and they had the big white collar that went around? That white collar back then was actually a napkin, because they would preach, and then when they got done preaching, they would go down and have this luncheon, and then they'd throw the napkin and wipe their face, and then they'd go back up and start preaching again, and they'd still have the napkin on. So now it's become like some kind of glorified thing. Like, you're not a real pastor if you don't have a robe on with a napkin around you. Look at where it came from. So I should probably put a napkin on my, and just put some dirt on it. Like, yeah, that's normal. That's what it should be anyway. But the picture painted for us anyway, the lengthy messages, verse 33. And after they had spent some time there, they were sent away from the brethren in peace to those who had sent them out. Verse 34. But it seemed good to Silas to remain there. This is really important. Another way God leads his church, and he's done this through history, is through the desires we may have personally. Silas just thought it good. I think it's really good that I stay in Antioch. It's pretty cool here. I'm going to check it out and see what happens. And really, that's the picture here. As this group of teachers and pastors headed back to Jerusalem, Silas is like, you know what? I'm going to just stick around. I like it here. It's cool. He had a desire to stay. And you know, when there's a desire there and it's focused on the Word of God, which is the right, he wants to stay there and help encourage the church, wants to stay there and help build the church, that's a desire that's right. And God works through those desires in the body. So as the book of Acts unfolds, and we're going to see shortly just how God uses Silas, Silas's personal desire to stay in Antioch, God's going to use it for his glory and for the salvation of many, many souls. So sometimes there's a desire. Think of back in history, like church history, God's always led the church through desires they have personally. I think of, in 1517 in Germany, Martin Luther. He's there, he's a Catholic priest, everything's going great, and all of a sudden he's reading the Word of God and there's his desire burning in his heart. Wow, I found hope in the Word of God. Wow, I've read the Word and there's hope in Christ. And a hope that he had not found in the religion he had been a part of his whole life. There wasn't an internal hope that he had in his soul. But coming upon the Word and understanding righteousness by faith alone, this desire began to burn inside of his heart. And he had a desire to see the Word of God translated for the common people into their own language. Because there was a hope the people were wrapped up in the bondages of their own religion. They were caught up in the selling of indulgences. They were caught up in things that meant nothing for eternity. Nothing for the eternal work or the hope of heaven. And Martin Luther was burning and he had a desire in his heart. Gotta translate this New Testament, this Bible, into German. So the people can read it in their own language and find out, wow, there's hope in Christ. There's no hope in my religion. It's not going to bring me on to eternity. It just keeps me in bondage with relics and with works and with labors that mean nothing for the kingdom of God. And he had a passion inside of his heart. And God took that passion, that desire that he had, and he opened the door for the Bible to be translated into German. And that started a reformation that's still alive today, that brought the Word of God to the people and brought the hope of heaven into a heart that never understood it. And amazing. You think of Hudson Taylor. If you ever read about Hudson Taylor, a young guy in England had a desire in his heart for China. It's like nobody back at that time was going to China. In fact, nobody cared about China in any way, shape, or form. And here's Hudson Taylor, and he's like, I just got a burden in my heart, a desire in my heart to see China saved. He had actually read about the Chinese. They were like many thousands dying monthly. And he was reading on different mission statements, and he was like, nobody is even caring about all these people dying in China. And he's had this desire in his heart. Gotta go to China. Began to read about China. Began to think about China. Had a desire for China. And what does he do? He goes to China. And he went through, if you read about his life, he went through tragedy. He went through some difficult times of sickness and pain and suffering, but he pressed on sharing the gospel with the Chinese. And you know what? Those who had never heard about the love of God or the love that God had for them began to hear. And hundreds and thousands were saved because of this man's desire to go to China. That's an amazing thing to me, you know? He shared the gospel enduring much suffering, but able to be used by God in seeing hundreds and thousands of lives changed and helped and saved. In Psalm 37:4, God says, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart." God has no problem when your desire lines up with his word. He has no problem altering time and moving things to see that work of the ministry through. That's like people that come to me and say, "You know, what about all the people in Africa that are dying? Who's going to reach them?" Like, do you have the desire to go there? If you do, go. Because maybe God's directing that. Maybe there's a desire. Maybe you're here today and you go, "I got a desire. This group in Brattleboro, I've been praying for them. There's a desire in my heart." Go share with them. What if they don't accept it? So what? What if they don't receive it? Who cares? What if one does? What if one person comes to the knowledge that it's not about my religious walk, it's about my relationship with Jesus Christ, and I never knew that before? What if one person comes to that, to the awareness of, I never knew I could have an intimate personal relationship with God and that he actually really loves me just the way I am? Is it worth one life if there's a desire there? Maybe you're at work and there's a desire in your heart. You know, Lord, I believe you got me here for these people to know you. If that desire is there, you can bet everything is going to come against that to get you thwarted, to get you focused on something else. And God's saying, no, I brought you there because you're the light of the world. And there's no other light needed but what you have inside you. And that's my son. Remember my dyslexic acronym? Remember that? Shine, shine. Show others his love. That's my dyslexic acronym. So you just work it out that way. But that's really all we're called to do. You got the light of Christ in you. If you believe in that Jesus died on the cross and rose again from the dead, God says, you're saved. That's my faith that brings me to heaven. That's my security that I'm going there. And that's the only light that is needed for all of mankind. There are some groups that seek more light and you get to the next level and they're like, okay, seek more light, and you get to the next level, seek more light. And like, how much more light do you need? That the Son of God died on that cross and rose again on the third day, offering the world life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him would not perish, but have what? Eternal life. And God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. This is the light of the world, what we are. And we carry that light inside of us, and we share it with everyone else. So as if your desire, if it lines up with the word of God, God will lead his church through the desires we may have personally to see that light shine forth. Look at verse 35. And Paul said to Barnabas, Paul and Barnabas stayed in Antioch teaching and preaching many others, also the word of the Lord. But after some days, Paul said to Barnabas, "Let us return to visit the brethren in every city in which we proclaim the word of God and see how they are." This is really cool here because God leads his church through the concerns we feel internally for each other. Very important. Paul had a concern. It's been about 5 years, Barnabas. Churches have been out there, and I'm really concerned. Concerned that they're still following the Word of God. Concerned that they're still walking in grace. Concerned that they're growing strong. Concerned that false teachers haven't come in and tried to redirect them some way. I'm really concerned about them. And that concern was very real and very important. I'm curious about them. And really, that's what Paul's saying. How are they doing? It's been quite some time. Let's go check on them and make sure they're okay. That's really important because this happens even today. Suddenly, you know, if you're a believer, suddenly you're there and all of a sudden a person comes to your mind out of the clear blue. You're sitting there and you're like, boom, I'm just thinking of this guy. I haven't seen him in 10 years. Wonder how he's doing. Or a situation comes up about someone and you're sitting there and you're concerned for some reason or you feel curious about what's going on. Or how someone's doing in your life. Well, that's the Holy Spirit giving you direction. Maybe to pray or to go and offer help. Or even sometimes just to stop and to not speak. Or to just intercede somehow. The way of the Lord is sometimes to lead us through concerns we feel internally. You know what God's put in our heart? Emotions. And the Holy Spirit actually governs those emotions, if we let Him. And there's a sensitivity that we have that non-believers don't have. And that sensitivity is nothing of ourselves. It's the Holy Spirit in us who can stir me to think of something I haven't thought of in a long time. Or maybe you wake up at 2 in the morning and for some reason somebody's really heavy on your mind. And you go, wow, I can't stop thinking of this person. That's the Holy Spirit going, hey, pray. You, now, for them. And you intercede. And sometimes it's all you can do. I remember a situation one time years ago, my wife and I were facing a situation with someone else, and this person was hundreds of miles away. And it was heavy. It was like life or death, and we're over going, what can we possibly do? I know. We can fall on our face and cry out to God to intercede. And we did that. We laid down on the floor and said, Lord, I can't even make a phone call to anybody for this. Only you can do something, and you've shook us up because of it, and we fall down and agree together, Lord, save this person, help this person, be with them. We cried out to God, and you know what? God answered that prayer. That person's alive and walking with the Lord today, and praise God for that. But the Holy Spirit works in that way. And leads the body in that way. And to me, it's just an amazing thing. In fact, Paul would write to the church in Rome in Romans 8, verse 27. He writes this, and he, that's the Holy Spirit, searching the hearts, knows what is the mind of the Spirit because he makes intercessions for the saints according to the will of God. Very important, Romans 8, 28. Because what Paul is telling the church there is that God leads his church through concerns we have for each other internally because the Holy Spirit in us is constantly looking out for us. The Holy Spirit in us is constantly caring for and interceding through us for one another. What do we do in evening prayer? Do we come together and we go, Lord, we've got to pray, make me a better person. Is that what we pray? Or do we intercede for people we know? Someone's stirred, someone's got cancer, and we know they're facing death, and we lift them up in prayer. Someone's facing difficulty at work, and we lift them up in prayer. And there's a burden that comes upon our heart every once in a while. You know what? I'm really burdened for these people here. Can we lift them up in prayer? You bet we can. That's why we're here. Sometimes I can't be there to do anything. But we can be here, and we can be together, and God leads in that way. And so many times, isn't it, the group that meets for prayer, how many times does God pour something out? We start to go down a list and it gets added to and added to, and then this heart, and I'm really concerned about this one, and we put them down, and God gives direction to the church through that. And it's an amazing thing, amazing work when we see it happen. So when I have a concern out of the blue for someone or some circumstance someone is in, it's actually the Holy Spirit tugging my heart in my mind to begin to intercede with prayer or with help for whatever is needed at the moment. So God leads in that way too. And I think it's important because as we look at, you know, Paul's first missionary journey, and we're going to get into his second one beginning next week, the Holy Spirit leads the same way. God leads his church the same way, always, and just moves all the way through history, and we can see it. There's a settling in it, and I think it's really cool. In verse 37, as Barnabas wanted to take John, called Mark, along with them also. But Paul kept insisting that they should not take him along, who had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not gone with them to the work. And there occurred such a sharp disagreement that they separated from one another, and Barnabas took Mark with him and sailed away to Cyprus, and Paul chose Silas and left, being committed by the brethren to the grace of the Lord. And he was traveling through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. So now we have this disagreement, and this is an amazing thing too, because it shows me, and we can take this part of the scripture and look at this disagreement. People usually say, well, who was right, Paul or Barnabas? And who was wrong? None of them. They were both right. They're both trying to trust the Lord. They're both trying to walk with God. They both see two different pictures with their eyes. Who's right? Who's wrong? None of them. One's trying to follow here. One's trying to follow this way. They come into a sharp disagreement. And it shows me something. You know what happens in the body of Christ? Sharp disagreements. Anybody married here? Anybody ever been married? Did you ever have a sharp disagreement? Like, no, yeah, yes, you absolutely. Sharp disagreements happen. You know why? Because we're human. Well, you're Christians. Well, we're human Christians. Sharp disagreements happen. It doesn't mean someone's right. Always remember this, and my wife shared this with me, if I get it right. If a husband and wife or two people are getting into the argument, and one of them walks away thinking they won, you both lost. If a husband and wife get into an argument, and one has to be louder than the other one to get their point across, and you walk away thinking you've won, that marriage lost. Because you just got divided. And you let the enemy divide you. And two people in the body of Christ, you get into a heated discussion, one walks away thinking you won, the other way, no, you lost. You both lay it down before the Lord. He's the great governor of the church. He directs the Holy Spirit. We listen to him. We lean upon him. We trust in him. And what we see in here is that as God leads his church through personal difficulty, never forget this, church, because God offers you and I as his bride so many ways to be directed by him, to walk in agreeing together on the word, to walk being led through gifted men and women in the body, to be led through gifts of the Spirit, to even be led through the desires we may have, to be led through the concerns we feel for each other internally. But I look at this in God, and I think as a last resort, often leads his church through personal difficulty. And I don't think it's the best way to be led by God. I think sometimes it's the only way for some of us. Because some of us, we get so thick-headed, you understand, that we don't hear, and we're trying to, and he gives direction. You know, you come in for the teaching of the word, God's word goes forth. You go, that was a nice sermon, Ron. Yeah, that was really great. Nothing for me in there, though, but oh, so-and-so was here. He could have heard that. And yet, and God gave the answer. And then he has someone come up, you're in there in fellowship, and you're talking, I'm really seeking the Lord with an answer for this, and somebody pops up a word of knowledge. Oh, no, 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 no. That was really great. Did somebody tell you about what I was going through? No. That was the Holy Spirit given. Then we keep going all the way. And then finally we get to this one spot, and God's like, okay, now we're going to use some personal difficulty because I can get through to you that way. I think it's much better to hear a word of wisdom and a word of knowledge, and I think it's much better to learn from a gifted pastor or teacher in the exposition of God's Word. And I think it's much better to receive counsel and understanding from a brother or sister in fellowship. But if you're like me, so many times, I don't know why, I'm just like dull of hearing and hard of heart to receive a word of wisdom. I walk away going, is that a word of wisdom? Well, let's see if it happens. You know, it's like sometimes I just don't hear. Or sometimes I'm not hearing, or I'm just too dull in my brain to make personal application from a Bible study. So, you know, God in His grace and in His mercy and His love for me says, okay, Ron, now I'm going to have you bump heads with someone because I'm trying to get through to give you the right direction. And I'll tell you, God is so faithful to do that in my life. He doesn't hold back. And when it finally happens that way, I generally look back in time and I see that he tried every other way to get through. And it's just that I just wouldn't hear it for some reason. I was stuck in my own way, standing upon my own opinion, based on my own thing. And God's like, okay, now let's butt heads with this one whom you served with for many years. Let's butt heads with this one whom you love and you know loves you. Let's butt heads with this one so I can get through to you in the direction I want you to take. It's like almost like sometimes I have to face yet another round of grievous pain for God to get through in directing me to stay on the right path that He's prepared for me. And I wish I could say, as I sit here as the pastor of the church, but I wish I could say that my spiritual sensitivity was at such a level as that I hear the whisper of God at every turn in my life. But I don't. I don't. But He is faithful to knock on the door of my head through some circumstance or some pain. I don't know about you, but God, I don't know that He loves to use pain in my life, but it just takes that in my life sometimes. I'm thankful for the times that I hear Him right away when He says, okay, take this direction. Yes, Lord, let's take this direction. Oh, this sweet moves good. And you're like, thank you, Lord, that was awesome. And it's painful for the times that I don't hear that. So I take great comfort when I read this to know that even the Apostle Paul and the Apostle Barnabas were directed by the Lord in such a way. God had a purpose for each one of them. Paul's purpose, to go out there and strengthen the churches. Barnabas' purpose, to take Mark under his wing and to walk this way. And boom, this argument happens, grievous pressing. And to me, I'm just thankful to see that. Because God still works the same way. Anybody understand that in their life? Am I the only one? Right? No. God works that way. But doesn't He get through? And when He gets through, isn't it a blessing? You sit back and go, Lord, thank You. Thank You for being a patient God who loves me enough to get through to me, to see me through to the labor You've prepared for me. I can't tell you how many times I've said that I've been here praying, and I'm just like, Lord, thank You so much for Your patience of breaking through where You had to break through, because I just couldn't see where You were going or where You wanted me to step. And You're so faithful, it hurts, I'm in pain, but I hear You. I see it. Thank You for that patience. And that's a grace I don't take advantage of in my life. It's a grace I'm very, very, very thankful for. And it's a grace every one of us have. So God directs His church in that way. And you know what's really awesome? You got this separation of Paul and Barnabas. God used personal difficulty to set Paul and Silas to send them out on their missionary journey and to take Barnabas and Mark and send them out a different way. And you know what's really cool in this? Paul and Silas, and we're going to follow their life. We're going to follow their life through the rest of the book of Acts. But Paul and Silas are going to be used of God to carry the gospel out into the whole region of what we know as the European continent. We're going to look next week at the European missions team that God puts together, and Paul and Silas are leading it. And they evangelize the whole European continent. And that's amazing to me. Absolutely amazing. But you got Barnabas and Mark, and this disagreement separated them. And Barnabas sails to Cyprus. Now, Cyprus is his hometown. So he takes Mark under his wing. He sails to Cyprus. But you know who also goes to Cyprus? Peter. And you know who bumps into Mark and Barnabas? The Apostle Peter. And you know what Peter does? Peter interns Mark. And what does Mark do? What was the first gospel written? Wasn't Matthew, wasn't Luke, wasn't John. It was Mark. The gospel of Mark was penned by this Mark. And it would not have been penned had he not gone with Barnabas to Cyprus and bump into Peter. And probably Barnabas had regretted all that went on, regardless of the fact. He hands Mark over to Peter, and Peter takes Mark and disciples him. And this kid writes the gospel of Mark, the very first gospel penned. Amazing. God works in strange and mysterious ways that we don't ever seem to understand. But aren't we glad He works? And we're thankful. We have the gospel for that. And to me, that's just an amazing thing that God, you know, you might think you're here today. Well, we had such a sharp disagreement. I don't know how God could ever use me again. Oh, He can. Oh, He can. And His desire is to. And maybe you're not going to pen a gospel because we already got four of them. But maybe you're going to preach a gospel. Maybe God's called you to carry a gospel into your workplace. Maybe God, yes, you're the one that God has called to carry your gospel into your generation, that gospel. You are the one that God has called to carry the gospel into your family. You're the one that's called by God to carry the good news of Jesus Christ and what He accomplished on the cross to a lost and dying world. You and I are. And we look at our shortcomings, our missteps, our failures, and we go, Lord, how can You possibly use me? Well, how could He possibly use Barnabas again? How could He possibly use Mark? Well, He possibly used them in a great and great and mighty way. And I think that God, again, He still works the same way today. This is how He leads the church. Six ways. I'm going to give them to you again. He leads His church through the church agreeing together on His word. Secondly, He leads the church through gifted men and women in the body. Third, He leads His church through the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Fourth, He leads His church through desires we may have personally. Fifth, He leads His church through the concerns we feel internally for each other. And number six, He leads His church, lastly, through personal difficulty. If we can't hear all the rest, He's so faithful. You know, the Bible says he disciplines those He loves. You know, my father disciplined me because he loved me and wanted to see me on a path that was right. And God, in His faithfulness, is so faithful to us and loves us so much. He's not afraid to discipline us. If that's the only way He can direct us, then you'll, like me, you'll hear in the back of your mind, you know, that sound of a belt coming through the belt loop, you know, you're like, oh Lord, I hear You now. I hear You now. But you know what? There's a faithfulness there. And we serve an awesome and mighty God. So as we look at this chapter, and I thought it was important to go back and just see how the Holy Spirit was leading the church, learn to let Him lead you in this way. And you know what will happen? You'll grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and you'll be used by God to share the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, to a lost and dying world. That's just what will happen. God will take you down that road. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's pray. So, Father, we thank You for this time that You've given us to open up Your word and to walk through. And, Father, I ask that You would take Your word that was taught today, that You would plant it deep down in our hearts, where it would take root and be watered by the Holy Spirit, where it would bear fruit for Your glory, where it would continue to teach us to lean upon and to trust in by faith the finished work of the cross of Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank You, we love You, and we just give this time back to You. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.